Recorded Books and RB Digital present Anthony Fokker, The Flying Dutchman Who Shaped American Aviation by Marc Dierikx. Narrated by L.J. Ganser. Chapter 1. New York, New York, December 1939. Among the shopping public, the heavy-set middle-aged man wearing his suit in a state of disarray, an advancing baldness hidden under the brim of his hat, does not immediately stand out. That this is the world's first aviation multimillionaire is not apparent by sight. The streets are busy in New York this first day of December, 1939. Although the war in Europe, now 3 months old, is far away, New Yorkers hasten to department stores, such as Saks Fifth Avenue and John Wanamaker. For weeks, they have been luring customers with advertisements that this may well be the last time they stock imported luxury items. Expectations are that the Christmas sales will be 10% higher than in 1938. The splendid fall weather is beautiful for shopping, in anticipation of winter, which has been exceptionally slow to set in. New York relishes an autumn that goes on and on. Indeed, it is so warm and dry that City Mayor Fiorello LaGuardia has announced special precautions to supply Manhattan's trees and plants with extra water, something normally done only in the heat of summer. LaGuardia, nicknamed the Little Flower after his first name, has an eye for nature. Since his appointment as mayor almost 6 years ago, he has had Central Park restructured and replanted. And it is not just flowers and plants that he loves. As an aviation enthusiast, former pilot, and bomber commander in the Great War, he is also the driving force behind the creation of a new airport. After 2 years of construction and $40 million in costs, this is his big day. At 3 minutes past midnight, he is to welcome the first scheduled airliner, a flight from Chicago. With this event, the New York Municipal Airport will officially become operational on the beach of the borough of Queens. Several leading personalities from the world of aviation have been invited to witness the event. Among this select group is Anthony Fokker. It is already past midday when the porter opens the door of the former Viceroy Hotel at Park Avenue and 59th Street for Fokker. In the luxurious hallway where marble and gold glisten in the lamplight, his appearance seems slightly incongruous. Yet, he feels at ease in this environment. He knows the building, although it has changed much since its grand opening in 1929. In the wake of the Great Depression, the owners reconditioned the 32-story building. Its 525 rooms have been made into apartments to be sold individually. What has not been sold has been leased. Even Delmonico's, a well-known specialty restaurant once frequented by wealthy New Yorkers, is no more. It is quiet in the hallway when Fokker reports to the reception desk. In his somewhat awkward, Dutch-riddled English, he tells the receptionist he has come for his appointment with Dr. Robert Cushing. In anticipation of the gathering at the airport this evening, he has traveled from his house in Nyack, in upstate New York, to seek release from his persistent splitting headaches. From the lovely village on the southern bank of the Hudson River, the drive to Manhattan has taken some 45 minutes. The road through the rolling wooded landscape high above the river is well known to him. Since moving into his mansion, Undercliff Manor, in the summer of 1937, he has often driven this route. His old house in the woods near Alpine appears unchanged as he passes. At Brookside Cemetery, just outside Englewood, New Jersey, much has remained the same as well. From the road, he can see Violet's grave on the high grounds, where he buried his second wife after she met such a tragic death. He has driven here hundreds of times, when he still had his factories at the Teterboro Airport and in nearby Passaic, New Jersey. His German companies closed long before. Only the Dutch factory is left, far away in Amsterdam. He interferes with it as little as possible and prefers to spend his time on one of his boats. Outside Englewood, Fokker turns left across the new George Washington Bridge that leads to New York. From the high bridge, he can see Riverside Drive with his former apartment on the corner of 101st Street, which he abandoned after his wife's death in 1929. He arrives late for his appointment with Dr. Cushing. Being late is something Anthony Fokker relishes, the prerogative of an homme arrivé. Even President Warren Harding had to wait 30 minutes for him at the White House 17 years ago. There is no need to rush anyway. Cushing has seen him often enough. His ailment has been the same for years. Chronic sinusitis, a condition he has picked up after many years of flying in open cockpits. Today, his face is again taut. Breathing through the nose exhausts him. It almost appears as if the congestion in his forehead presses on his eyes more than usual. His whole head feels heavy, and even his neck is rigid. Dr. Cushing's practice is pleasantly light and spacious. Its low-slung sofa suggests an ordinary living room rather than a doctor's office. This is no coincidence. Cushing caters to an affluent clientele and wants his patients to feel at ease. His specialty, osteopathy, is a relatively new alternative treatment in 1939, aimed at providing relief for patients suffering from reduced flexibility of body tissues and bone structure. The treatment involves special manual techniques. As is customary, Cushing asks his patient to lie down on the sofa. He will manipulate Anthony's skull, vertebrae, forehead, and nose with his hands. These maneuvers are meant to improve the circulation and the pulsations of brain fluid, stimulating the cerebral membrane and the membrane of the spinal marrow. The technique should, at least temporarily, reduce the headaches and make the patient feel better. Although the manipulations are not painful in themselves, their duration makes the treatment unpleasant. Therefore, it is better to sedate the patient so that he will be able to relax fully. Cushing applies nitrous oxide, known as laughing gas, a commonly used anesthetic that is both fast and effective. Anthony receives a cap over his nose and mouth and is instructed to take a deep breath to relax. A wondrous feeling of tiredness descends upon him, and within seconds, he floats into a deep sleep. With great care, Dr. Cushing then feels and manipulates Anthony's skull. For an hour, his hands apply pressure in several places to equilibrate the bodily functions and restore the mobility of the bone structures. When the treatment is over, he waits for the patient to wake up. Today, it takes longer than expected. Much longer. Whatever the physician tries to bring his patient around, nothing happens. Hours pass. Finally, there appears to be no other option but to call for an ambulance, which brings him to Murray Hill Hospital, a mile away in Midtown Manhattan. This hospital caters to the rich and famous who live in the Murray Hill district. Cushing holds a position there. While preparations begin at New York Airport for the landing of the first scheduled flight, Anthony Fokker sails into the undetermined sphere between heaven and earth. In the days that follow, worries mount at Murray Hill Hospital. Examinations reveal that Fokker's loss of consciousness is not so much an unforeseen effect of the anesthetic, but rather is directly linked to a much-feared bacterial infection, pneumococcus meningitis, which causes encephalitis. The bacteria must have invaded from Anthony's sinuses and colonized his nose and throat cavities, subsequently entering his bloodstream. Now it has affected the membrane that normally protects the brain and the spinal cord. Severe headaches and stiffness of the neck are the symptoms that accompany this condition. In 1939, an effective treatment does not yet exist, although experiments with an anti-meningitis serum have been conducted by the Rockefeller Institute for Medical Research since 1904. Failing a serum, the disease persists, pulling the patient into a downward spiral of semi-consciousness and unconsciousness. The complications increase. In Holland, newspapers report of pneumonia on top of everything else. Semi-oblivious, Anthony Fokker is fighting for his life. Chapter 2. Java, Netherlands, East Indies, April 1890. It had taken Anna Fokker-Demont half the day to reach the government hospital in Blitar with her horse and carriage, The wet western monsoon had taken hold of Java, and the roads were covered in puddles and mud. For months, the clouds hung low around the slopes of the Kelud volcano, where she had her home on the coffee plantation, Nunur, with her husband Herman. She had chosen a dry day for her trip to Blitar, and thanks to the dispersing clouds, she could now enjoy the landscape with its rice terraces. The route was beautiful. The first part, along the horse track that the planters had built connecting the model gardens of Kali Tapak, and the tea and rubber plantations of Gogoniti and Singrong, had taken her to the village of Walingi. From Walingi, the great postal road curved for some 12 miles through desas, across bridges, and through rice fields and dry land. Blitar, one of the strongholds of the Dutch colonial administration on eastern Java, was a quiet town with about 9,000 inhabitants. Its wide avenues joined at the central grass square, which was lined with trees. The town was known for a mild climate that lent itself to the recovery of the sick and ailing. A Dutch civilian physician resided at the government hospital on the edge of town. Here, modern medical care could be provided to European women in childbirth. It was best for expectant mothers to make the journey early, rather than await the first signals of labor on a plantation. At Nunur, Anna would have been dependent upon the assistance of the Dukun Baji, the native midwife. Midwives were few in number in the Kadiri district, and Anna, like other Dutch women, had no faith in them whatsoever. To give birth to her first baby, her daughter, Katarina, nicknamed Toos, she had traveled all the way to the district capital Kadiri to be certain of the services of Herman van Buren, one of the few European doctors in the area who specialized in childbirth issues. Now she was to have her second child. Fortunately, everything went well on Sunday, April 6, 1890, and after some days recuperating in a Blitar hotel, Anna returned home to Nunur as a proud mother with her infant son, Tony, Anthony Herman Gerard Fokker, in full. Now that the rain season was nearing its end, the intensity of the precipitation lessened by the week. In June, the dry eastern monsoon would make Kadiri's coffee shrubs bloom, covering the volcano's planted slopes in white flowers that spread an intoxicating sweet smell. Then the red coffee berries would ripen until October, when it would be time to harvest them before the rains returned in November. In the last quarter of the 19th century, coffee growing had boomed in the Dutch East Indies. In Europe, coffee had become a popular drink. Growing and trading it was lucrative, since this took place under the protective umbrella of colonial rule. The Netherlands Trading Company, Nederlandse Handel Maatschappij, or NHM, had obtained a monopoly on exports in 1824. Until recent years, growing export crops had been the prerogative of the state, but in 1870, new agricultural laws had come into force that allowed for private farms and plantations. After tea, sugar, and rubber, coffee growing had seen a quick rise since then. The climate on the volcano slopes of eastern Java proved eminently suited for it. In fact, the district around the provincial town of Kadiri had effectively become known as coffee country. Without exception, these coffee farmers were Dutch. Most of them had settled with the support of the NHM, which provided capital and supervised businesses. Coffee plantations were often quite large agricultural estates of 250 to 1,000 acres. Planters obtained land cheaply under government leasehold contracts for a 75-year term, as the colonial authorities claimed ownership of all the island's non-productive soil. Annual turnover in such an enterprise would easily run into several hundred thousand guilders, more than $100,000. Planters often had 200 to 300 employees working for them, mostly native people. One such planter was Herman Fokker, descended from a wealthy family of ship owners and merchants from Middelburg in the southwest of Holland. For many generations, the Fokkers had worked in the colonial trade. Herman was born on January 26, 1851, as the seventh and youngest child of the merchant and tanner, Anthony Hermann Gerard Fokker, 1809 to 1874, and his wife Maria von den Brucke. Hermann's father, Anthony, the combination of first names Anthony Hermann Gerard was a family tradition, was then vice president of the Middleburg Chamber of Commerce and a deputy commissioner of the NHM. Expectations were that Hermann would follow in his father's footsteps. But young Hermann did not fit well within the small circle of Middleburg's social and business elite. Unlike his brothers, who made careers in law, commerce, and science, he had trouble completing his education and even prided himself in adopting an anti-intellectual attitude. His unruly behavior strained on family relationships considerably, until his father resolved to send Hermann to a boarding school in Germany, hoping that foreign experience might bring improvement. It did not work. However, the Fokkers were not the only wealthy family to struggle with such problems. The accepted solution was to encourage an unruly son to leave for the East Indies, in hopes that he would calm down. And so Hermann boarded one of the ships of the Rotterdamse Lloyd, destined for the Dutch East Indies capital, Batavia, Jakarta, soon after the death of his father on August 27, 1874. There he was met by his senior brother Anthony, born 1842, the secretary of Batavia's plant and zoological garden. Encouraged by his brother, Hermann Fokker went to work in the coffee as an overseer. While Hermann sweated on the plantations, his brother Anthony made a rapid career for himself in the years that followed. On March 18, 1878, Anthony even became a full board member of the Fokkerie in Batavia, the Dutch East Indian branch of the NHM, a very select grouping, which consisted of only two members and a president. Brother Anthony's new prominent position soon came in handy. In October 1879, their mother, Mary Fokker von den Brucke, died in Middleburg. Hermann now had a substantial inheritance to deploy. In consultation with Anthony, who of course had very good contacts in the colonial administration, the brothers decided that Hermann should invest his money in a coffee plantation. Given the high profits they expected, this seemed a sensible decision. It took a while before the brothers had located a suitable site, but on September 29, 1880, Hermann Fokker acquired a leasehold on about 500 acres on the southern slope of the Kelud. He was not alone there. In all, 64 planters were farming around the small provincial town of Wellingi. Nieuwnuur, as it was known locally, was situated on a sloping terrain, rising from 1,300 to 1,500 feet in altitude. It was located between the streams of the Simut and Suso rivers, adjacent to the horse track leading from Wellingi to the hamlet of Semen, higher up the Kelud slopes. The task awaiting Hermann on his new property was not an easy one. To begin with, the land had to be cleared and prepared for planting. This meant removing and then burning the existing trees and shrubs. Thereafter, the ground had to be leveled and organized into proper plant beds to obtain a structured plantation in which the coffee seedlings could grow. Not before 1883 was he ready for the first coffee plants to be put into the ground. In 3 years, he planted 175 acres, with as many as 113,567 coffee shrubs. Then, patience was called for, because 3 years were required before a coffee bush would yield enough berries to be harvested. Meanwhile, the opportunity arose to increase the size of the plantation with another 50 acres in May 1885. After preparations, Hermann planted a further 95,441 shrubs in 1888 and 1889 that provided berries by 1891. By Hermann's own estimate, this resulted in a harvest of more than 30,000 pounds of coffee in 1893, with a market value of about 60,000 guilders, then approximately $24,000, in Batavia. Yet the costs were significant as well. From the beginning of the plantation in 1880, Hermann spent 265,385 guilders on Nieuwnuur, partly on an expensive Lidgerwood pulping machine, that turned out a complete disappointment. Moreover, the 1888 and 1889 plantings suffered considerably from the dreaded coffee leaf disease, a fungus that devastated entire harvests on Java, and against which virtually nothing could be done with the knowledge of the day. In his first years at Nieuwenhuur, Herman Fokker was more than busy making the place work. But by 1888, things had progressed enough that he dared leave his plantation temporarily in the care of the garden superintendent he had hired a year and a half before. On January 13th, he embarked in Samarang on the steamer Prince Alexander of the Netherlands Indies Steamship Company, destined for Batavia. Exactly 2 weeks later, he left from there for the Netherlands on board the Samarang of the Rotterdamse Lloyd. His intent was to return with a bride to keep him company in the remote planter's house. In 1888, a Dutch woman on a Javan plantation was still fairly uncommon. Most coffee farmers looked for affection closer to home and lived in concubinage with native women. Yet Herman Fokker had searched for love within his own family circle. In late February, he set foot on Dutch soil in Rotterdam and was engaged forthwith with his 22-year-old cousin, Anna Diemont, 16 years his junior. It was an arrangement that had been proposed by letter and that suited both parties. The links between the Fokker and Diemont families went back for generations. 3 months previous to Herman's arrival, Anna's mother had passed away, and now she only had her older brother August left as next of kin. Her father, a theologian and preacher in the Walloon Reformed Church in Arnhem, had died in October 1884. Herman and Anna exchanged their initial vows on March 18th. The wedding ceremony itself was held in Arnhem 11 days later. On March 31st, local newspapers carried a brief message of gratitude that Mr. and Mrs. Fokker-Diemont wished to thank their friends and relatives for the evidence of interest experienced in their marriage. The young couple took 3 months to get used to each other, before Herman embarked in Amsterdam on June 23rd aboard the Princess Marie for his return trip to the Dutch East Indies. For his young bride, this journey took too long. Prompted by family members who had preceded her, Anna chose the comfort of the boat train that ran along the French coast, and she joined Herman on board in Marseille. 4 weeks later, they put in at Tanjung Priok, the Batavia port. They were met by Herman's brother Anthony and his wife Suzanne, who offered them several weeks of hospitality in their spacious Batavian villa, overlooking the central square opposite the palace of the Governor General. Not before late August 1888 did the couple finally arrive at Nieuwenhuur. It was there, in the simple planter's house, with its wide galleries and its wide cantilevered roof that Herman had built, that their marriage took shape. For Tony and his sister Toos, their early years on Nieuwenhuur were a source of fond memories. In the small circle of the plantation, the two children of Tuan and Nyonya, Mr. and Mrs., held an exceptional position, constantly guarded by their caring Babu, the native nurse. Little by little, they expanded their territory from the dark interior of the planter's house with its plastered bamboo walls to the shaded galleries around it. In their outdoor living area, father had his own recliner, mother her rocking chair. The dining table was outside as well. Well apart from the house stood the kitchen, full of smells and sounds, where the staff prepared meals. On the forecourt, Tony and Toos played between the drying beds for the coffee berries and the establishment, the workshop that housed the coffee peeling machinery. When the machine was not working, as happened intermittently, native women sorted and picked the coffee berries and bit them open with their teeth to rid the beans of their skin. Before long, the barns and the nursery for coffee and cocoa plants also became part of their world. The stable was one of their favorite spots. Here, the Fokkers kept two riding horses, a few cows and calves, chickens, ducks, and even a monkey named Case. A bit farther away, on the edge of the yard, stood a watermill powered by a drainage pipe that Herman Fokker had linked to the Suso River. It also served as a bathhouse. The yard's little fountain with its pointed red roof A remarkable detail that Anna captured in a delicate oil painting she made of Nyunyur in June 1892 also operated from the water pipe. On the other side of the house, about 160 feet up the hill, the overseer's house was located, and near it, the kampong, where Nyunyur's workers lived. Beyond that point, the coffee gardens stretched, with high and low coffee shrubs interspersed by cocoa plants. High above this, specially planted shade trees rose with their bare trunks. To little Tony, this was the most wonderful place he could possibly imagine. It was like paradise. Life on Nyunyur was less carefree, however, for Hermann and Anna. Owing to leaf disease, to which the Java coffee variety that Hermann had planted was particularly susceptible, the coffee harvests from 1888 were disappointing. In the disaster year 1890, the entire harvest on Java collapsed because of this blight, plunging by 80%. The next 2 years were better, but in 1893, the harvest dropped again, this time by 61%. Meanwhile, local competition increased rapidly. Every year brought new plantations, bringing pressure on prices. In 1893, a kilo of coffee fetched 13% less than the year before. Hermann Fokker regarded these developments with growing concern. He reacted by putting excessive demands on his workforce, for which he was publicly scolded in the regional newspaper. But unlike most other members of the Kadiri Agriculture Society, he was not completely dependent on the income from the plantation. On many long evenings, Hermann and Anna sat on their veranda discussing what to do. Amid the typical sounds of the tropical night that seeped in through the matted windows, Tony and Tos heard the seriousness in their parents' voices. They thought that Mom and Dad were worrying about the options for their education. This was not so. In April 1893, Hermann asked his brother Anthony to have the NHM send an appraiser to bid on Nyunyur. He himself believed that the plantation, in which he had invested a major part of his inheritance and so much of his work effort, would be worth around 175,000 guilders, $70,000. But although the appraiser acknowledged that Hermann had done his utmost to make the plantation a success, he did not see fit to exceed an evaluation of 150,000 guilders, $60,000. That was way short of what Hermann wanted, and the result was that no sale materialized. Hermann then tried selling the property privately, placing an ad for a Nyunyur in the Lokomotiv, Samarang's trade and advertising newspaper, in December 1893. Meanwhile, the decision to leave had been taken. Because they were financially independent, Hermann and Anna could afford to depart, even without selling the plantation. Moreover, Hermann's brother Anthony, his powerful mentor in Batavia, was also due to leave for the Netherlands with his family in May 1894. Given the circumstances, it did not seem to be a good idea to remain in Walingi, hoping for better times. After 4 months of almost continuous rain that came with storm winds heavy enough to cause trees to be uprooted, berries thrashed, and the harvest again threatened, Hermann and Anna Fokker left for the Netherlands with their two children at the beginning of the dry season of 1894. Furniture and household goods were, as was the colonial custom, auctioned off to interested parties. Yet the sale of the plantation itself still did not come about. For several years after his departure, Hermann continued to be listed as the entrepreneur and administrator of Nyunyur. Meanwhile, he tried to find a buyer in the Netherlands. It took him until March 1896 before he finally agreed to an offer, but the 160,000 guilders he now hoped to get still did not materialize. A group of 11 Dutch investors from The Hague, revolving around the affluent Evers family and united in the Schravenhagse Koffiekultur Maatschappij, the Hague Coffee Culture Company, that had been founded 6 months before, eventually paid him 120,000 guilders, $48,000, for the plantation. That, incidentally, was also Nyunyur's 1897 tax value. One Philip Evers, son of the main founder of the Coffee Culture Company, became the new planter. Even then, things did not go well at Nyunyur. In 1898, the plantation was no longer listed in the government almanac. That year, several leasehold operators pulled out of the Walingi district altogether. The eruption of the Kelud volcano in May 1901 destroyed what was left of the plantation. By 1911, the estate had become run down and almost overtaken by wilderness. The Fokkers' 1894 journey from Walingi to Batavia was quite a trip. The first stage brought them to Malang by carriage, a distance of about 40 miles. From there, a train service ran to Surabaya, where they boarded a steamer for Batavia. A day later, the Fokkers reached Batavia's port Tanjung Priok. On May 16th, they embarked on the steamship Von Diemen, a freighter with passenger accommodation of the Royal Packet Company, that brought them to Singapore, the first stop on the long voyage to Holland. From the railing of the ship's sail-shaded stern, they watched the tropical Dutch East Indies recede and slowly become smaller. But if the adults viewed the scene with mixed feelings, for Tony, the world aboard the mail ship with its pounding engines was just another big adventure. The journey left him with a lasting fascination for boating and ships. Chapter 3. Naarden, Holland, March 1910. The first day of a fresh army recruit started with waiting and idleness. From 8:30 in the morning until 3 in the afternoon, the new conscripts bided their time in an exercise of obedience and patience. At last, Tony Fokker was assigned to the 9th Company of the 2nd Regiment of Fortress Artillery at Naarden, about 15 miles southeast of Amsterdam. The journey from Haarlem to the Naarden-Bussum rail station was by train. From there, the fortress was half an hour's march. Tony used the opportunity to get on a friendly footing with his sergeant by offering him a handful of expensive cigars that he had brought on purpose, to which the sergeant proved most susceptible, Tony wrote in a letter to his mother. Once in Naarden, the recruits were fed first. After that, the troops were aligned in the parade ground in front of the Promers' barracks and addressed by the commanding officer. Then they were dismissed to the quartermaster, where everyone was issued the customary dark blue tunics, white pants, blue cap, and dark greatcoat of the fortress artillery. A short-sticked shovel and a handful of personal items completed the gear. Tony found his fork, spoon, and mess tin all equally greasy and dirty. Only the food itself, potatoes with beans and meat, proved passable, and even most edible. The barracks themselves gave Tony a shock. The Naarden Fortress, inhabited by 630 soldiers and 100 officers, and situated under more than 8 feet of earth, represented a completely foreign, hectic world. Once past the gate with its fierce-looking lions that held the royal coat of arms, Je m'entendrai, a long, dark, vaulted corridor led away from civilian existence. In the bomb-free brick passageway, every footstep echoed. The corridor divided the complex in two. There was a cold draft. Here, privacy did not exist. Tony was given one of the 56 low wooden sleeping bunks in one of the barracks' 6 dormitory caverns, and introduced to his sleeping mate on the bed next to his. As a mere soldier, his own private space was no larger than a section of planking attached to the wall at the far end of the dormitory, and the rock-hard straw bag that formed his bed. In the middle of the dormitories, bare wooden soldiers' tables stood, with planks to sit on attached to the legs. Chairs were provided only in the sick bay. There was a single stinking communal toilet and wash facility for the whole garrison. Only the officers had better accommodations, meaning they had their own chairs to sit on. Tony found these circumstances very difficult. He longed for home. Discouraged by the Spartan conditions, he tried to file for a medical discharge that same day. But in the small cubicle all the way in the back in the dark of the sick bay, where the military physician examined him, his skewed leg was given no attention whatsoever. The doctor barely listened to his complaint of having uneven legs. Undeterred, Tony inquired about the opportunity to have a second examination later that week. His request was summarily dismissed. A soldier's existence was proving to be nothing like the protected civilian life in Harlem that he had just left. Harlem, 12 miles west of Amsterdam, was a city beloved by returning colonials. Since their arrival in 1894, it had been the residence of the Fokkers. In June of that year, Herman, Anna, Toos, and Tony had finally set foot in Holland after a sea voyage of about 5 weeks from Batavia. With the years of hard work in the tropics behind him, Herman Fokker now found time for his cigar, good company, and a game of billiards. But for the children, Harlem was a strange, cold world they did not know and did not understand. For Tony, the move meant leaving everything behind. He and Toos had trouble feeling themselves at home in their new surroundings. The children acted withdrawn and behaved shyly. In many respects, the Dutch city on the Sparna River was the opposite of Nieuwoor and Walingi. Its streets were paved and narrow, and its high stone houses made Tony and Toos feel small. Only the trees and the grass of the Haarlemmerhout Park on the outskirts of the city reminded them of Java's lush greenery. Luckily, the Fokkers passed their first summer in a hotel along the Haarlemmerhout, because the house that Herman had bought was not yet ready when they first arrived. The Hotel Widow Vandenberg was the final stop of the horse-drawn tram from the station. It had been built in 1889 at the most beautiful spot in the park, with a big fountain in front and overlooking a deer pen. Widow Vandenberg also had modern amenities, such as private balconies for each room. For that reason, it was especially popular among summer guests. The quiet environment of the Haarlemmerhout helped the children adjust. Then, on August 1st, Herman registered himself and his family as the new residents of Kleine Houtvek, number 41, now 65, just outside the city center. Number 41, a typical Dutch townhouse of the period, had few features that stood out. It was about 25 feet wide and 40 feet deep, located on the edge of the old town. Initially, it had been designed as a somewhat stately town mansion, but in the course of construction, it had been divided into two residences that essentially mirrored each other. It overlooked the Fredericks Park, a view of which Herman soon became fond. For little Tony, moving to Harlem was not easy. In contrast to the house on Nieuwoor, where the inside and outside interlaced, and where the children had their own foal that moved in and out of the house like the dog did, the doors at Kleine Houtvek were usually closed. The building did not even have a front yard. Visitors were shown straight into a small vestibule that doubled as a hallway or into the adjacent antechamber. A door with decorated glass panes gave access from the vestibule to a narrow corridor that split the house in two. The left side held the antechamber, the basement entrance, and the kitchen and pantry, primarily intended for the small house staff. On the right side of the corridor was the living room, with ensuite dining. From there, double doors led to a 100-foot-deep garden where the children could play with the sheepdog, Max. Between the hallway and the dining room was a niche containing a toilet and built-in stairs that led to the second floor. At the top, one entered a small, somewhat dark landing that gave access to three bedrooms, a guest room, a bathroom, and, luxurious for the time, a second toilet. Behind a closed door on the landing, a second staircase led to the attic. The attic's rear included three small bedrooms for the kitchen help and two maids. Their chambers were separated by a walkway from the spacious storage room in the front. For a modest-sized family such as the Fokkers, it was a large house, equipped with such modern conveniences as a bathroom with running water. Yet, none of this appealed to little Tony. He later remembered the house and garden as constricted. The Dutch climate did not help. For the first time in their lives, the children had the strange experience of snow. What Harlem had in abundance was water. A mere 650 feet from the house was the canal that separated the old city from the new expansion where the Fokkers lived. On the quays at the Weyhouse and along the Sparna River, ships moored daily to load and unload. Few were seagoing vessels. Most ships were inland barges and other freight-carrying vessels rigged with sails. But for young Tony, water and ships exerted an irresistible attraction. The same could not be said of school. At the nearby elementary school, Tony proved himself a mediocre student. In his own words, "School and I didn't agree at all. Active, high-spirited, full of inventive ideas with a practical turn to them, I found study a boring routine, monotonous in the extreme, something which the teachers did little to make more interesting." Hermann Fokker's little boy Tony soon became a byword and a hissing to the irritated pedagogues. It has since seemed to me that most of the teachers showed a lack of imagination and of any real teaching ability when they attempted to force a square peg into a round hole. Despite his ingenious methods for spying, about which he boasted in his autobiography, he invariably ended at the bottom of his class, yet only had 1 year in which he was not promoted to the next grade. At home, the storage room in the attic was Tony's preferred spot. Here he built his own little world, which gradually took shape from all sorts of loose objects that he gathered. He was a creative child, with a special gift for tinkering. Before long, the floor of the attic was filled with miniature rail tracks, constructed from tiny strips of metal. He ran self-built toy trains on these with his friends, and later undertook experiments with electricity, miniature steam engines, and Bunsen burners that ran on gas he illegally tapped from a pipe that ran to their neighbor's house. Tony also showed prospects as a tradesman. His mother preserved an early bill from the Electrotechnical Bureau Fokker and Company for the total amount of 40 cents, charged for soldering caps on some lead piping. The water also beckoned, although his father refused to buy him the small boat he longed for. Undaunted, at 12 years of age, Tony managed to build his own small canoe in the attic storage room. Hermann Fokker, who encouraged his son's tinkering activities from time to time, was sufficiently impressed to have the canoe hoisted out the attic window and brought to a nearby wharf to seal the vessel's planks and have it painted. No matter how much agony Tony suffered in primary school, his years of secondary education proved worse. In the summer of 1903, his father registered him at the Municipal Higher Civilian School, HBS, which offered a 5-year program. The school had a good reputation, and Tony had to pass an exam to get in. To the relief of his parents, he was accepted. From September 1903 until December 1908, a good part of his life took place within the high walls of this institution. The school was located on a square just behind Harlem's City Hall, a mere 10 minutes' walk from Tony's house. It was an imposing building, with hollow-sounding corridors and classrooms high enough to enable an amphitheater arrangement in the biology and the physics rooms, so that pupils had a better view of demonstrations and tests. Since the school's founding in 1864, the number of pupils had risen considerably. When Tony began classes, about 200 students were enrolled, which resulted in a lack of space and classrooms. To address the problem, several adjacent houses were added to the school building, creating further organizational discomforts. Some classes, such as drawing and arts, were taught in former living rooms, garden rooms, bedrooms, and the like that could be reached only through a maze of passageways and stairs that were never built for the number of persons using them. Such classes seemed at the end of the world, as a former pupil later remarked. Eventually, a second school building was opened in a nearby converted gas factory in September 1907, but overall, the facilities remained substandard throughout. Tony Fokker was an unmotivated student, and his results showed it. Although he was conditionally promoted after his first year, he ended that year failing in no less than 6 subjects: geography, history, Dutch, German, French, and even draftsmanship. The school principal, Hotze Brongersma, resolved to sit him in the first bench in every class so that his teachers would be able to keep an eye on him. More often than teachers later cared to remember, he was disciplined because of pranks and even suspended for several days, which was much to Tony's liking as it provided him with extra time to spend on his various hobbies. There was nothing he liked better than playing hooky, and he was seldom in search of excuses to do so, honoring the adage high on the wall in his biology class. Knowledge means much. Character means more. In a commemorative issue of the school paper, published on the occasion of the school's 60th anniversary, he recounted how he would hide out until the concierge was back from his rounds to report absentees. Then Tony would reappear, panting and pretending to be out of breath, his hands oily from the chain of his bicycle that had supposedly broken, begging to be stricken from the absentee list and allowed to rejoin his class. If the concierge allowed this, Tony would quietly escape to spend his day on the Sparna River. More than once he had to report to the boss, Brongersma, an old and gray gentleman who ruled the school with dignity. Once Brongersma summoned him on the customary free Wednesday afternoon, Tony daringly protested that I didn't understand why the headmaster would sacrifice his own free afternoon to rob me of mine, thus punishing himself without having committed any wrongdoing, which I found completely illogical, an argument that he found so right that he released me on the spot. Such occasions were, of course, exceptional. He would have to repeat his fourth year as well, after showing a report card with no less than 10 subjects in which he had failed. In his autobiography, he noted, "History and languages, I couldn't have cared less. Speech practice, I found gruesome." In the end, gymnastics was the only subject in which Tony demonstrated real talent. For geometry and physics, his grades were passable, but only just. Yet in algebra, chemistry, mechanics, history, and modern languages, he came nowhere near passing. Pranks were more his thing. Stink bombs, shooting pellets. As results did not improve, father and son Fokker threw in the towel at Christmas 1908, at the end of a disastrous first semester of his second year in the fourth grade, the equivalent of an American student's freshman year. Tony was glad to close the school doors behind him. As he put it, "I've learned all that I can." Instead, he focused on his big hobby, water sports, rowing his skiff, sailing his small dory-class sailboat, which required great concentration to avoid capsizing. For his boundless enthusiasm, he had already been elected second commissioner of Harlem's Rowing and Sailing Club at the annual meeting on February 22, 1908. Contemporaries called him a daring sailor. At the Amsterdam dory races, Fokey, as he was fondly called at the club, won several prizes. Water was his big passion, and there was no risk he would not dare to prove it. Once he connected a long plank to the roof of the boathouse and laughingly rode his bicycle over it into the Sparna. Spectators cheered as he reemerged and swam ashore with his bike in hand. On dry land, the attic remained his domain. Here he pondered various experiments and in the process developed a new interest, aviation. In 1909, aviation was still a new phenomenon that was conquering Europe rapidly. Spectators flocked by the hundreds of thousands to spectacular air meets, even if they had to travel for days to get there. The newspapers were full of the latest events and achievements. On June 27th, the very first airplane took off from Dutch soil. Boys dreamed of an exciting career as an aviator. Soon, Tony was among those who wished to learn all about flight. Technical knowledge about aviation, however, then existed only in the heads of less than 1,000 people worldwide, and it remained inaccessible to a 19-year-old school dropout without qualifications. Yet, Tony paired a creative mind with a keenness that was way above average, working with what information that did reach him to expand his understanding of the phenomenon of flight. He tried to gain some first-hand knowledge of aerodynamics. From celluloid, he cut small, basic airplane-shaped models and launched them from the attic window. he constructed representations of the steering mechanisms of planes that he had read about and had seen photographs of in newspapers. He also embarked on an engineering adventure with his friend and classmate, Fritz Kramer, another unruly spirit who shared a history of bad behavior and came from an affluent family. Hermann Fokker's means, however, could hardly compare to those of Jakob Kramer, Fritz's father, who had been chairman of the board of the NHM and of the Delhi Company, which traded in colonial goods such as tin, tobacco, and other commodities, and who had also been the nation's minister for colonial affairs. The Kramers lived in an enormous mansion on their private estate outside Harlem, Daun and Kraudberg. Jakob had the house and grounds specially built and furnished to meet his every demand as a millionaire. It was there that the two young friends embarked upon the development of an idea that had been in the back of Tony's mind for some time, a car tire that would minimize the risks of springing a leak. Fritz was ideally suited as a partner in such a venture. The Kramers possessed two automobiles, and Jakob had no objection to lending his aging 1904 Peugeot Type 66 to the boys for their experiments. In the garage of Daun and Krautberg, the boys had plenty of room to tinker to their heart's content. Air-filled rubber tires were prone to puncture on the badly paved roads of the day. The solution that Tony and Fritz tried to develop was a steel shackle belt that would be attached to the wheels by a system of springs and torsion rods. This effort might be classified as a form of reverse engineering, going back to the massive wheels that had been used on carriages and coaches with modifications. The garage space and the project budget had to come from Jakob Kramer, yet Tony's father, Hermann, was prepared to file the patent application on May 24, 1909. In the meantime, Tony and Fritz had the time of their lives trying to make the old Peugeot go as fast as it possibly could. They practiced alongside the railroad tracks, the car's leather sides taut in the wind, trying to keep up with the fast train into Amsterdam, and had themselves photographed as racing drivers, standing next to the vehicle. For over half a year, the boys tinkered away at the Peugeot before the project ran aground. They found that a patent similar to theirs had already been filed in France. The disappointment over the car tire was only the beginning of bad news. In December 1909, Tony and Fritz were called up for military service, a distinctly unappealing prospect for the pair. They attempted to simulate flat feet at their medical examinations, but both young men were found to be physically fit. Tony was drafted in March 1910, and for him, there was no option but to obey. The Kramers were in a much better position to dodge the draft. Jakob Kramer launched an appeal, and on his father's instructions, Fritz left on a world tour with his older brother Marnix and a distant cousin. For a year, Tony and Fritz were almost completely out of touch with each other. When Tony reported for duty at the Naarden barracks, his friend was dancing at the Penang Golf Club in Malaysia. Indeed, Fritz's departure had been so unexpected and quick that the two friends hardly had time to say their goodbyes. Fritz wrote to his father from Malta to inquire what had become of the automobile tire scheme. Until December 1910, Jakob Kramer remained involved in proceedings to exempt his frail son from military service. Naarden itself, a small fortress town with about 4,000 inhabitants, surrounded by earth walls and moats, was a bitter disappointment for Tony. Centuries of occupation by rotating garrisons had left its traces in the streets. Although the town was one of the key strongholds in the water defenses southeast of Amsterdam, contemporary photographs show it to have been in poor repair. Within the town's high earth walls, both the bigger and smaller houses were built low to shield them from gunfire. On many houses, the brickwork showed traces of soot and of humidity. Window frames and doors were in need of a fresh layer of paint. Only the main street with the town hall and church was presentable. The murderous steam train that ran from Amsterdam to Laren passed through the street to the Utrecht Gate. Except for military movements, guns and supplies being moved around, This practically summarized all traffic there was in Naarden. For a city lad from Harlem, the small garrison town was less than boring. It was a hole to hang yourself. Unlike his fellow conscripts, Tony hardly appeared to notice the pub-like recreational facility that stood next to the parade ground in front of the Promers' barracks. Weeks went by with the usual drills and exercises for the new recruits. Weeks in which Tony did his utmost to get noticed in a negative way, by falling out of step as often as he dared. Although his grades for gymnastics had been the highest on his report cards at school, he now pretended not to be able to run because of his flat feet. The coincidence that he had caught a bad cold and thus coughed continually worked to his advantage. He was sent to the sick bay to recuperate, a recovery that was encouraged by confining patients to a strict diet of bread and milk. Yet, Tony persevered in his act. His performance was convincing enough for the doctor to send him to the Naarden Military Hospital for examination. Although conditions there were a step up from those in sick bay, the hospital wards had real beds instead of wooden bunks, and there was a table with chairs for recuperating soldiers who were allowed out of bed, the diet of milk, water, and rice did not agree at all with Tony. He begged his mother, "Please send me some butter and cookies and lots of sugar, dark brown and white, and some sausages in a tin. A little money, please, plus or minus 250. Getting an early discharge proved difficult, however. The military doctor took hardly any notice of Tony's complaints and prescribed strict bed rest, plus weekend detention. He was not allowed off the hospital premises and was confined to its enclosed garden even on Sundays, which he feared would be boring to death. His subsequent plea to be allowed to visit his sister in Amsterdam for a couple of hours was grudgingly granted, and he was allowed to visit his sister on a Monday evening. That visit proved a prelude to a speedy return to civilian life. When he jumped off a moving tram in Amsterdam, he lost his balance and fell, badly bruising his ankle on the curb. The immediate result was that he was taken to the Amsterdam Military Hospital, where all they gave him were wet bandages. Again, he was prescribed bed rest. The game lasted for 2 more weeks, while Tony complained in whining letters to his mother that the charade was taking up the time he had planned to spend on re-equipping his sailboat. "My chocolate powder is all gone now, and the sugar too," he wrote to his mother. "Please send, or better, bring a whole lot. The sooner the better. I am completely out of things. I gave the guy who inspects the postal parcels a cup of my chalk, although he is not allowed to take this. Sick! I'm really not splashing it about, but the cups here are really big, and the bread is barely buttered and dry." Mama also sent him money. Tony needed little encouragement to use that to further his early release, promising his ward sergeant 25 Dutch guilders, about twice a man's weekly wages then, to help him obtain a discharge. His letter continued, "Help of your ward sergeant is worth its weight in gold. To remain good friends with him is really a prerequisite, because if such a man is against you, there is no escaping. I've promised him 25 guilders if he gets me a discharge. A boy from another ward has done the same in similar circumstances. It looks like a lot at first sight, doesn't it? But don't forget what you're gaining with this, and his help is the main cause that things are going so quickly for me. Well, quickly for here, that is, mind you. He is ward sergeant and assistant to the doctor in all operations, hence makes good money, so you can't send him off with a small bribe. Anyways, I'll be cheaper off here than in Naarden. Patience alone is now the cue." The money would prove well spent for Tony. The financial massage helped procure his medical discharge. It was the first time money enabled him to wriggle out of commitments, and it was a lesson that would stay with him. Dreaming of a career as an aviator, he returned home in the automobile his parents gave him for his 20th birthday. Chapter 4. Mainz, Germany, July 1910. The decision had been his father's, and Tony found it terrible. School in Germany sounded like an expulsion order. Nonetheless, Hermann had stood his ground and ordained that it was time that his son should finally learn a trade. As he himself had attended a boarding school in Germany, this was where Tony ought to follow. To ease the suffering, at least a little, Hermann had agreed that Tony's friend and neighbor, Tom Reinholdt, could accompany him in his search for lodging. In the last week of July, the boys took a train from Harlem, Holland, to Cologne, Germany, where they looked around under an overcast sky full of rain clouds, and then finally boarded the river steamer to Mainz. In his autobiography, Fokker noted, "The thought of going away to school frightened me to death, feeling very much as if I was leaving for the end of the world. I don't remember when I ever was so discouraged." To a boy for whom the Dutch North Sea coast between the villages of Katwijk in the west and Domburg in the southwest of the country had hitherto represented the far ends of the familiar world, Germany was an unknown country where people spoke a language he barely understood. The Rhineland dialect with which people greeted him sounded nothing like the German he had learned at his Harlem high school. Everything was different in Germany. The landscape with its mountains and river valleys, the cities and villages with their unfamiliar architecture, the culture of beer and wine. Even the food had an unusual taste. Tony developed a lifelong preference for Dutch cookery. What had driven his father to send him here, where he was so much left to fend for himself? Of the river journey and the beautiful landscape along the Rhine, he later remembered little other than that he had felt more dejected with each mile covered. July 1910 had turned out to be an overcast, wet, and cool summer month. It had been 2 months since Tony had come back from the Naarden fortress to live with his parents in Harlem. Life suited him fine, tinkering in the attic storage room, playing with Max the dog, or sailing with old friends on the Sparna River. But what was to him a perfectly enjoyable way to bide the time was agony for his parents. Day after day, they saw young Tony in complete idleness, without a school diploma, without work, and without much purpose in life. Even his mother, who had secretly entertained hopes that Tony might somehow end up at the Delft Polytechnic, was at the end of her wits. Matters were made worse when other family members started to ask questions about young Tony, or tried to interfere. The whole family began concentrating intensely upon my career, except me. I hadn't thought much about it, and resisted their efforts. Meanwhile, Tony himself had more or less decided he wanted to become an aviator. He just lacked the courage to tell his parents about it. The idea had grown on him since January 1909, when he had visited the 8th edition of the annual Brussels Automobile Show with his father. He had been fixated by the 3 Belgian airplanes that were on display there amid the automobiles. The machine of Jean de Crovez, Pierre de Carter's triplane, and Audemars de la Hoze, orthoptère, a peculiar apparatus that its inventor hoped could fly by simulating the wing movements of a bird. Flying, that was what he wanted. He would have preferred to have been allowed to depart for France immediately upon his return from military service, to attend the flying school of airplane constructor Antoinette in Châlons-en-Champagne, near Reims, the center of the French aeronautical effort. There, young daredevils were instructed in the art of flight, for a hefty price. Tony later complained that, "I received no encouragement from my parents. They viewed flying, as most people did at the time, as the shortest way to the cemetery." Indeed, the life expectancy of pilots was limited in those days and could be counted in months rather than years. Hermann Fokker flatly refused to contribute to an adventure that would inevitably lead to his son's death. Between father and son, many a difficult hour passed discussing Tony's future without any resolution in sight. In June, Hermann's patience ran out. He insisted that Tony should go to Germany and learn a trade, no matter what. After considering the episode of tinkering with the Kramer's old Peugeot, Hermann believed that Tony should be trained in automobile technology. A decision had to be forced, he thought, because I did not tolerate him around the house as a loafer. In the end, father and son agreed that Tony would be registered for a course in automobile technology at the Technikum in Bingen, some 20 miles west of Mainz. The Rheinisches Technikum was housed in an imposing four-story building on the outskirts of Bingen, between the vineyards along the Rhine and the Klopp Castle. It had been founded in 1897 as a private college for the sons of the well-to-do, and was renowned in and beyond Germany for its training in electrotechnology and mechanical engineering. In 1910, as many as three-quarters of the school's pupils came from abroad. Hermann Fokker was satisfied with the education he had selected for his son. Did not electricity and things mechanical precisely match Tony's activities in the attic? Besides, the Fokkers had friends living in Bingen, the Koning family, who could help Tony get settled and might offer him advice and assistance if necessary. But when Tony arrived in Bingen on July 30th, his first impression of the school building made his heart sink. The Technikum was even larger and more imposing than his school in Harlem, where he had felt so miserable. Was this really where he had to register? It looked as if there were no other option. Yet his father had not enlisted Tony for the Technikum itself, but for a chauffeur's course associated with it, a private initiative of the school director, Hermann Hupke. His registering for the chauffeur's course had everything to do with the fact that Tony did not possess a high school diploma. Contrary to the Technikum itself, the chauffeuring course required no prior qualifications, and whereas the school itself possessed several automobiles, the chauffeur's course was only sparsely equipped. To Tony, the whole setup looked like a swindle to exploit young people's wishes to learn to drive and maintain a car. A short walk around the premises was enough to convince him that this situation was not for him. He wrote to his mother. In the afternoon, we had a look around in the chauffeur's school, a small square garage with two automobiles, one rickety four-cylinder and one-cylinder. Beyond that, an assortment of old iron, cars of at least 10 years old, not in driving condition and without tires. Everything listed in the prospectus is inflated in such a way that I am astounded. There was just a single turning lathe the size of a sewing machine. No forge. The whole prospectus is humbug, and it would be throwing good money away to attend. One only learns here how to drive, plus what's required for the government's driver's license. Anyway, we are not going to the chauffeur's course. It's a waste of money. Pity I am here now. However, Tony and his friend Tom Reinholdt, who had accompanied him to the school, dared not tell Director Hupke what they thought of the chauffeur's course, and so Tony signed up for it. Afterward, he left it to his parents to write to the principal and ask to have his registration papers back, as there has been a change of plans. If he doesn't agree by any chance, he can whistle for his money anyway, as he cannot exercise control over a minor in Holland who does not have the legal power to sign a contract, so the whole thing will be void anyhow. Hermann's acquaintance in Bingen, Mr. Koning, came up with an alternative. He directed the boys to a similar school in Mainz, the Erste Deutsche Automobilfachschule, First German Automobile Trade School. Since January 1907, this had been an independent branch of the Technikum in Aschaffenburg. The two friends took the train to Mainz, where they were met in the adjacent locality of Zahlbach by the school's director, Rudolf Kempf. Tony was immediately impressed. Much better than Bingen. Better known, has a much better reputation. The driver's course of the automobile trade school had begun in November 1904. Since then, more than 1,000 candidates had received their training there. The school was supported by the larger German automobile manufacturers and had been authorized to issue driving licenses in May 1910. Initially, the trade school's activities had focused on mechanical engineering courses for the automobile industry, but in the latter years, the side curriculum of the driving school had taken off. The course took no longer than 4 weeks. Every first or 15th of the month, new entrants were welcomed to start the course, which consisted primarily of an introduction to the automobile engine and to the car's various mechanical and body parts. Cars in those days were prone to failure, and owners had to be able to make their own repairs on the spot. The trade school had also started a course for owners of powered boats in April 1907, and in October 1909, a third course was added on aeronautical technology. This was advertised as the Fachschule für Flugwesen, Aeronautical Trade School. Like the other specialized courses, the Aeronautical Trade School was very much a hands-on affair. In the school's workshop, the participants joined in the construction of a genuine airplane. In May 1910, the school went one step further and advertised that it would offer flight instruction as well. This pilot's course had as its broadly phrased aim to offer future professional pilots, future engineers, and airplane constructors the opportunity to get acquainted with the design and construction of the airplane. A course of 4 to 6 weeks was considered sufficient for this objective. Compared to the training courses offered in France, the tuition was modest, 500 marks, about $120. According to Fokker's autobiography, the actual costs for the course were double that amount, as students were required to provide an equivalent security deposit. Although the total investment was thus considerable, it was nonetheless an amount that Hermann Fokker might be willing to pay for his son's fascination with flight. How to proceed from there was a matter to be decided at a future moment. Meanwhile, this opportunity was the chance of a lifetime. It took some imagination to recognize more than the driving school in the assorted sheds and buildings near the former Carl Ludwig Marx paint factory in Saalbach, just outside Mainz, of which the Aeronautical Trade School was a subsidiary. The basic training consisted of driving around the school grounds with a propeller vehicle, a contraption that was powered by an airplane engine. But there was more. In October 1909, the first group of trade school students had started on the construction of an airplane. Soon they discovered that the grounds at Saalbach were not big enough for maneuvering the machine, let alone taking off. In April, the school had therefore erected a wooden shed at the army parade ground of Dotzheim, near the village of Niederwalluf, just across the Rhine outside Wiesbaden. The Dotzheim terrain measured 1,600 by 1,400 yards, big enough even to fly, which of course was the final goal. On July 21, 1910, the commander of the Wiesbaden garrison officially agreed to the use of the parade ground. So, Tony Fokker had arrived just at the right moment. He was excited. This was just what he wanted. Nonetheless, he took care not to show his eagerness to his parents, nor report on the school's aeronautical curriculum, lest they would put a sudden stop to his participation. He wrote to his mother, "The only thing left for me to do now is go home and then decide whether I shall go to the Technikum or to the trade school in Mainz, which will begin in October." In anticipation of his parents' answer to this question, Tony and Tom waited in Mainz and Wiesbaden for a few days before collecting the answering letter in Rüdesheim, across the Rhine near Bingen. It turned out that Hermann Fokker had agreed to the change of plans, and in early October, Tony Fokker signed up as one of the 23 students who had taken the course in aeronautics since 1909. In the meantime, part of the aeronautics course had moved from Saalbach to the shed at the Dotzheim parade ground in August 1910. The trade school's one and only genuine airplane, a Farman biplane with a pusher engine, was hauled through the streets of Saalbach and Mainz the day after the city had been featured as a staging post for the first German overland flight from Frankfurt to Mannheim. The shed at Dotzheim was thereafter identified by the rather inflated name of Fliegerhalle, Pilot's Hall. Subsequent taxi trials at the parade ground soon proved that the only airplane engine that the trade school possessed would not be powerful enough to get the plane off the ground. Moving across the field at some speed was all it was capable of. In other words, the machine was too heavy, although a project was already underway to construct a lighter version of the Farman. The man to coordinate the effort was Bruno Buchner, the aeronautical trade school's recently appointed teacher. Although he was an engineer, cyclist, and racing driver, Buchner did not yet possess a flying license. But he could nonetheless boast of some experience in aeronautics. He professed to have taken lessons in France at Louis Blériot's flying school, and then to have worked at the Anzani airplane engine factory. Buchner had also been involved in experiments at Berlin's showcase Johannisthal airfield and at Bork near Magdeburg after earlier successes in speed contests and in repairs of vehicles. Even before classes started, Tony found out that Buchner and a second trade school teacher had plans to travel to Paris with their seven students to visit the second International Aeronautical Salon at the Grand Palais from October 15th to November 2nd. Tony immediately sent a letter to his father, begging to be allowed to join the outing. The 150 marks that this would cost were, he wrote, not too much and not too little. However, I have been unable to save this amount from my monthly allowance and would therefore like to be sponsored, as it is for my study. He offered to combine the return journey with a visit to his parents in Harlem, hoping to convince them of the sound reasons for his preference to go into aviation. Not an easy task, as a skeptical Hermann had lost patience with his unruly son by now. On a specially inserted page, Tony begged his mother, "Speak well for me. I shall come home no matter what, even if I have to pay for it myself. But if coming home is really absolutely unwanted for keeping the peace or something like that, then write me as soon as possible, and I will go back to Mainz from Paris with the rest. Write me back as soon as possible, or send me a telegram. Okay, if all is well, and I can go and come home, half, if no payment will follow, but I can come home, not if I should not come home, but proceed to Paris on my own expenses." To Tony's intense frustration, Hermann refused even to consider the plan, and in the end, Tony was forced to cancel the whole trip for lack of funds. Despite his initial enthusiasm, the trade school's aeronautical curriculum turned out not to be quite what Tony had expected when it started, after a week's delay on October 24th, 1910. With its duration of only 6 weeks, the training was short, even by the standards of the day. Nonetheless, it formed Tony's introduction to the coveted status of aviator. His plans had evolved in the months that had passed. Initially, he had only aspired to acquire knowledge of how to build a plane. But after coming to Dotzheim, he now hoped to learn to fly one. Knowledge was his first priority now. The training at the trade school consisted of a theoretical introduction in the classroom in Saalbach, where students were familiarized with the basics of construction theory, followed by a practical sequence at the workshop in Dotzheim. The first 4 weeks were primarily spent in the classroom, learning about engines, electrotechnology, propellers and their construction, and airplane design. After that, barely 2 weeks remained for actual practice, which was largely spent working on the lightweight version of the Farman biplane. Together with his six fellow students, Tony labored on the construction challenge. The idea was that the new machine would receive an engine that would power a pulling rather than pushing propeller. But would it be possible to fly with this new airplane? The course was scheduled to end by mid-December, so there was not much time to find out. A stronger engine would improve the chances of achieving flight, but such engines were expensive. Purchasing costs ran into the thousands of marks. Fortunately, one of Tony's fellow students managed to locate an airplane engine that had more horsepower than the first one. It thus appeared that the project could proceed. On November 5th, however, less than 2 weeks after the start of Tony's course, the trade school received bad news. The military garrison issued instructions that all flying activity would henceforth be prohibited within a radius of 6 miles from the fortress of Mainz. This sudden move was instigated by the recent discovery of the potential of aviation and of aeronautical espionage by the German military. It appeared that their interest would preclude any flying by the trade school students at Dotzheim. Moreover, the decree singled out foreign pilots especially. Although the school's director, Rudolf Kempf, was offered the chance to finish the ongoing course, the end of the school's aeronautical training was now suddenly in sight. Of course, this decree dominated the talk of the day among the students, who believed their chances of becoming aviators were evaporating. A sense of urgency pervaded. All the students' muscle and effort were put to work getting the lightweight biplane ready for flight before the decree's deadline. Thanks to the stronger engine, the new airplane indeed left the ground. Its pilot, Bruno Buchner, however, who was to obtain the 53rd German pilot's license on February 3, 1911, did not dare risk anything beyond a short hop into the air. The plane came down with a bang, badly damaging the machine. Perhaps the effort to reduce weight had compromised the plane's structural rigidity. But since the primary goal of the trade school was to provide know-how and experience in airplane construction, this crack-up did not seem as disastrous to the school as it must have to the students. Tony was bitterly disappointed. In his autobiography, he would inflate the story of Buchner's flight to an utter failure that resulted in the complete loss of the machine. But perhaps his tears were real. All I could say was, "It is terrible," and sniffle. I was thinking only of myself and those letters I had written my father. In the meantime, a third plane remained unfinished. This was a simple monoplane based on the practical knowledge that the students had gained in Dotzheim. One less wing meant a considerable savings in weight. Possibly the trade school's engine would be strong enough to allow such a machine to fly. Contrary to the school's earlier planes, there was no design to follow for this monoplane, and it was developed on the basis of ideas that emerged on the spot. Tony Fokker, the group's most eager participant, provided quite a few ideas himself. And although his notions were instinctive, rather than based on actual know-how, they did turn out to be useful. He soon came to believe that, in fact, the entire design of the monoplane was his. On December 20th, after the course had been completed, Director Kempf formally received the written orders banning further flights. For the aeronautical trade school, which relied for a substantial part of its revenue on students from abroad, the decree came as a severe blow. All flying activity around Mainz came to a halt. Although Kempf entertained the idea of moving the aeronautical section of the trade school elsewhere, instructor Buchner packed his bags to continue his career with the firm Aviatik in Berlin. Tony saw his chances of learning to fly going up in smoke, yet he refused to give up his dreams. Frustrated, he claimed his security deposit back from Kempf, now that he would be unable to complete the course and obtain a flying license. For him, there was no plan B. Meanwhile, his fellow student, Franz von Daum, a retired first lieutenant in the German army from Breslau, came up with a remarkable plan to buy the half-ready monoplane from the trade school and move it to a different location where the machine might be finished. Although in his 50s, von Daum was intent on learning to fly and was willing to spend serious money. It was an attractive proposition for the school, given that it was unlikely to be able to continue its aeronautical activities in Mainz. Nevertheless, von Daum operated with caution. A junior partner willing to risk his neck in the adventure would certainly be an asset. This became the basis for an unlikely bond between the former professional soldier, Franz von Daum, and the draft dodger, Anthony Fokker. It was a bond to their mutual advantage. For von Daum, the investment in the monoplane was a relatively cheap way to attain his goal, now that the aeronautical trade school seemed as good as dead. In his young and eager assistant, he saw a keen helping hand, willing to take risks. For Tony, the offer from the affluent retired officer was a gift from heaven. He almost could not believe his luck. The matter did require another begging letter to his father, as von Daum wanted some financial input from his partner. To Tony's surprise, Hermann Fokker, perhaps glad that his son had finally found a cause worth fighting for, made 1,000 marks available without making a fuss. Tony used this money, together with the deposit that had been returned to him, and whatever means he had saved from his allowance, to invest in his share of the partnership. The fact that neither he nor Van Daun possessed any technological know-how beyond the short course they had just completed did not appear to be a major issue. The monoplane was already partly finished. Van Daun and Tony ordered the missing parts from a woodworker in Wiesbaden. Awaiting further developments regarding the no-fly zone around Mainz, Van Daun managed to obtain temporary permission to continue using the Dotzheim parade ground and the pilot's hall. But the two partners soon had to admit that their project exceeded their technical competence. They therefore engaged Jakob Gerdecker, an engineer who had acted as a construction consultant with the trade school. 8 years older than Tony, Gerdecker was a mechanical engineering graduate of Aachen University, where he had studied with Professor Hugo Junkers. Junkers, in his turn, had undertaken various tests and projects with his Aachen colleague, Hans Reissner, among them the design of new wing constructions for airplanes. After finishing his degree at Aachen, Gerdecker had started working on a plane of his own in an empty shipyard in the village of Niederwalluf, some 6 miles to the west of Dotzheim, in August 1909. By April 1910, Gerdecker's project had proceeded far enough to have the machine transferred to the parade ground of Grossensand in Gonsenheim, just outside Mainz on the other side of the Rhine, where the plane could be tested. There was also ample space for an aircraft shed. Although Gerdecker had initially limited himself to taxiing the plane across the field, he saw his pilot Paul Lange take his Taube, dove, into the air before the month was out. From then on, Gerdecker's shed carried the large white lettering, Flugmaschinenwerke, Airplane Works. Construction was not limited to Gerdecker's own designs. It also included work for others. The deal with Van Daun and Fokker was that Gerdecker would help them in constructing the monoplane, in return for which Tony would act as Gerdecker's demonstration and test pilot once he had his flying license. For the time being, Van Daun and Fokker's main concern was to get their plane ready for flight. This proved far from simple. They had ordered various parts from different suppliers, from local woodworkers, from Gerdecker, and from the carriage factory of Georg Krook in Wiesbaden. Fitting and assembly posed problems. They also still faced the issue of finding an alternative airfield outside the Mainz area. If Tony, a foreigner, was to fly the plane, it had to be relocated. Even Gonsenheim was too close. Van Daun remembered that air meets had been held in Baden-Baden in June and July. On the occasion of the Iffizheimer Rennwoche, Iffizheim Race Week, the airfield of Baden-Urs had welcomed the ultimate wonder of German aeronautical technology, the enormous airship Zeppelin LZ-6. The Deutsche Luftschifffahrtsaktien Gesellschaft, DELAG, the German Airship Service Limited, had established one of its operational bases at Baden-Urs. However, the LZ-6 had been lost on September 14, 1910, going up in smoke as the result of a fuel accident in the airship hangar. It meant the field's enormous shed now stood empty. The two pioneers sought shelter there. Without mentioning his junior partner, Van Daun wrote to Baden-Baden's mayor, Reinhold Fieser, known as a fierce supporter of aeronautics, asking for permission to use the airship hangar as a temporary base to test his monoplane. The matter was, he wrote, somewhat urgent, and he hinted that he had several offers from other airfields willing to welcome him. Hence, he needed a decision forthwith. On December 9th, Van Daun came to Baden-Baden to meet with Fieser. He said it was his intention to initiate trial flights, strictly for sports purposes, from the city airfield with the flying machine he himself had built, possibly as early as the next week. Fieser had no objections and was even prepared to negotiate with DELAG for a cheap lease of the airship hangar on behalf of Van Daun for an initial period of 4 weeks, if this could put Baden-Baden on the aeronautical map again. On December 19th, the two partners took up lodgings in the luxurious pension Landhaus Roche in the Schützenstrasse on the outskirts of Baden-Baden near the airfield. Van Daum liked to be comfortable. The next day, he and Tony descended to the facilities at Baden-Oss. There, the plane that Van Daum had transported in parts from Mainz lay waiting for them to be reassembled. Van Daum estimated that this work would take about 4 weeks. He hoped they would be able to start within the next few days. Not before the end of January 1911 was everything more or less ready for the first test flight. Left to their own resources, it had taken the two partners longer than expected to assemble their flying machine. Several specially ordered parts had also been late in delivery. In the meantime, Tony and Van Daum discussed the unknown options for controlling and steering the machine while still on the ground. Beyond that, there was the question of how to control the machine in flight. Like most early planes, their machine had no means of directional control other than wing warping. Tony, who, like Van Daum, regarded the monoplane as his own, dismissed any reservations his partner expressed, professing to be more than willing to take the risk of flying it. In trials, he managed to make several short hops into the air, some as long as 100 feet. It made him ecstatic. The machine could actually fly. In 3 months' time, he had progressed from a complete novice to the coveted status of aviator, and this on a machine that had incorporated ideas of his own. There soon was a price to be paid for this rapid success. For weeks, Tony exerted himself, sweating away in the cold, drafty airship hangar. Countless times, he and Van Daum swung the engine into life, after which the plane would start to move by itself, with Tony chasing it on foot, gasping to catch up and climb onto the moving machine. On top of these efforts, he braved wintry weather while racing across the field on top of the plane at a speed of some 40 to 50 miles per hour. On February 3rd, 1911, Tony was forced to take the train home to his parents in Harlem to recover from a bad case of pneumonia. Franz Van Daum, who regarded the monoplane as his, and who had thus far furnished most of the money, remained behind in Baden-Baden. Understandably, he took the control stick once Tony was out of sight. His flying adventure, however, ended with a resounding bang when the plane hit the only tree on the whole airfield, or so Tony cared to remember years later. The only trees at the Baden-Oss airfield were off the actual landing area. Van Daum informed him of the crash by telegram, after which Tony hastily returned. On February 23rd, he inspected the wreckage and had to admit that the plane looked beyond repair. Their dreams of flight lay in shatters. The mishap had its effects on the relationship between the two partners, which took a turn for the worse. In a letter to his mother, Tony referred to Van Daum's generally known stupidity. By necessity, the two pioneers moved back to Mainz, where Kempf's continued protests to the military authorities had resulted in the lifting of the restrictions on flying. With other ex-students of the trade school, Karl Schumm from Germany and Arthur Grunberg from Estonia, Tony moved into a small cottage in the woods near Gonsenheim's Grossensand. "The three of us live here at the Krim, Crimea, and it is good to live a bit cheaper again, although the circumstances are fairly bad. The soup tastes like petroleum, and there is spinach here every day." In the 6 weeks that followed, a record, according to Tony's letter, a new and improved machine was constructed in Goodecker's workshop, an activity paid for but shunned by a remorseful Van Daum. By the second week of April, the new plane was ready for its first tests. This time, Tony managed to stay airborne for several hundred yards, after which his seat on top of the fuselage gave way in a hard landing. Soon after, the group in the Crimea was augmented by a Dutch friend of Tony's, whom he knew from the annual holidays on the beach, at Katwijk with his parents, Arnhem-born Bernard de Waal, and Tony had characters that matched. Both had unruly minds and a history of problems at school. Like Tony, Bernard hoped to learn the aviation trade with Goedecker, who now had plans to open his own flying school at the Grossensand that spring. Meanwhile, Fine-tuning the second Fokker von Daun plane took time. Not before early May was the machine ready for its first official test flight. On May 4, 1911, Tony risked the dangerous maneuver of attempting to make a turn. With success, he rounded the airfield three times and managed to attain a height of about 150 feet. 12 days later, around 7:30 in the evening of a rainy May 16th, Tony felt sure enough of himself to test his skills as a pilot. Before a sizable crowd and two representatives of the Sports Commission of the Deutschen Luftschifferverband, German Association of Airshipmen, he steered his Spider into the air at the red flag on the airfield that marked the testing stretch for his licensing flight. To qualify, he had to make two flights of about 3.5 miles each. At a height of 300 feet, completing a pattern of 5 figure 8s was required. To register the flights, the Sports Commission had erected two poles at Grossensand, 500 yards apart. Tony was to circle these while making the figure eights. At the final landing, he was ecstatic. He could now officially register as an aviator. To celebrate, he flew an extra round around the airfield with von Daum in the passenger seat. On June 7, 1911, he received Germany's pilot's license number 88. Trying to follow suit, von Daum was less successful. On May 30th, he made a bad landing with the Spider, again damaging the plane. While awaiting repairs, Tony went to work for Goerdecker as promised and started giving flying lessons. The partnership with von Daum did not survive the new damage. On June 12th, the Mainzer Anzeiger carried the news that Fokker would no longer use the von Daum plane and was to have his own machine built at Goerdecker's. He was now earning money as a pilot.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.